Pulpits once again. Some of you are here for the first time. We've been doing this for 32 years, and many of you in the audience have been coming for 20 or 30 years, and we're just eternally grateful for your support for Humanities West. On behalf of the Board of Directors of Humanities West, I welcome you to yet another program in our 2014-15 season. This one will be followed by the cultural aftermath of World War I, May 1st and May 2nd. And then in your program, you will find the programs coming up for the following season, our 2015-16 season. The tickets go on sale on April 15th. We think it'll be April 15th. And those programs include Dawn of the Renaissance, the Italian Renaissance, Shakespeare and Cervantes, who happen to have died on the same date, and the world of the Celtic peoples. So we hope that you'll enjoy the following season as well. I have a very brief thing I have to do this evening because we're extremely fortunate to have a moderator with us. Someone those of you who have been with us for a long time know, Professor Fred Astrin from San Francisco State University, and I'll introduce him in just a minute. But before that, I have a captive audience, and I want to ask all of you in the audience, if you're not yet a patron of the arts, a donor to the arts in San Francisco, I ask you tonight to open your heart and your pocketbook and give to the arts in San Francisco. Humanities West is really fortunate. We earn about 45% of our income from ticket sales, which is at the high end of nonprofit organizations. We also have with us tonight Clear Story, which will perform after the intermission. It's a nonprofit organization, also reliant for more than 50% of its income from donations. We also are in this beautiful theater, Marines Memorial Theater, which is a nonprofit organization, a 501c3. And also, if you give to Marines Memorial Theater, you will be helping nonprofits like Humanities West have lower rates for renting the theater. So please think about making the arts in San Francisco one of your giving priorities for 2015. Humanities West is especially grateful to Bank of the West, which supports our teachers and students who come here on scholarship tickets to all of our programs and have workshops for the teachers on Saturday afternoons, and always to Grants for the Arts, which gives us a continuing grant every year. So if you're from out of town and you're staying in a hotel, the tax that you're paying on that hotel room is great because it supports the arts in San Francisco. So, enough for the sell. It's really my great pleasure to introduce to you this evening Fred Astrin, who's no newbie to Humanities West audiences. You may have seen him in our Baghdad program, where he absolutely wowed everybody in the audience with his lecture at medieval Baghdad. And so Fred is going to be with us for today and tomorrow as our moderator. He is chair of, and professor of Jewish studies at San Francisco State University. And I'll get off the stage, and here he comes.
Thank you, everybody. I'm delighted to be here. I always love coming to these programs. And I really love that you're here because you've come here to learn something close to a professor's heart, to a teacher's heart. You've come here to learn about the past, to celebrate the past, but I also think, very importantly, to affirm our relationship to the past and to all of humanity. And I think it's especially meaningful today when in Mosul, the heritage of humanity is being destroyed by the activists of the Islamic State. And here we sit, embracing that past and embracing the things from the past that are meaningful to us. Our focus for the next 2 days is Carolus Magnus in the written Latin of the 8th and 9th century, or Charles the Great, but we don't call him that. But let me move next in the introduction to a different Charles de Gaulle, who in 1950, in a speech, says, "I see no reason why, if the German and French peoples overcome their mutual grievances and the intrigues of foreigners, they should not end up uniting together. In effect, this would be to rebuild on modern foundations, economic, social, strategic, and cultural, the achievements of Charlemagne." Anticipating today's European Union, de Gaulle set the stage for Charlemagne's important place in the contemporary European political imaginary. One of the major edifices of the European Quarter in Brussels, the capital of the EU, is the Charlemagne Building. Or to cite another example, the European Charlemagne Youth Prize. Of course, such symbolism works two ways. In a recent book, a British medieval historian clearly locates himself in the opposition to the EU when he describes Charlemagne as an incestuous mass murderer. For a century before de Gaulle, symbolic evocations of Charlemagne were fairly uncommon in Europe on account of their use by Napoleon, whose imperial project was remembered as a trauma on the continent. He once said, I am the successor, not of Louis XVI, but of Charlemagne. Charlemagne's symbolism was actively embraced earlier in Napoleon's career, to cite one example, in connection with his coronation in 1804. But by 1806, the Napoleonic French Empire was being framed in new ways. A similar back and forth in regard to Charlemagne is witnessed in the Nazi regime. Earlier, when German humiliation at the hands of the French was an issue after World War I, Charlemagne was framed as the enemy, the Saxon slayer. Duke Widukind, the 8th century Duke of the Saxons, was the hero. Later, with the evolution of the idea of the Third Reich, Charlemagne was rehabilitated as a German hero, Karl der Große, and founder of the First Reich in the form of the Holy Roman Empire. Even among the French in the late Middle Ages, Charlemagne was transformed from an empire builder into a Christian sovereign, as the crown sought to seek independence from the papacy. Accordingly, he was canonized, Saint Charlemagne, in the 12th century. And 16th century French historians use Charlemagne as a device to debate the nature of the kingdom. Was Charlemagne the medieval restorer of ancient traditional liberties, or was he the legitimizer of the unnatural and corrupt power of the nobility? Who was this important and historiographically protean and enigmatic figure? Charlemagne or Karl der Große? Hero or villain? I look forward to finding out as we embark upon a journey of discovery with our presenters in this fascinating program. It's my privilege, it's an honor to begin our program by introducing our keynote speaker, Geoffrey Koziol from UC Berkeley, who received his PhD from Stanford. His focus is in the late Carolingian and Capetian periods of French history, and he's interested in politics and ritual, monasticism, political power and religious discourse, and he especially works on the study of charters and diplomas, about the documentation of empire and society. Among his many publications include a fairly recent book, The Politics of Memory and Identity in Carolingian Royal Diplomas, The West Frankish Kingdom, 840 to 987. Without any further remarks, let me introduce Professor Geoffrey Koziol.
Good evening, everyone. Make sure you ask about the incest tomorrow. Can I move this down? Alexis de Tocqueville, which is probably not a name you expected to hear tonight. In Democracy in America, Alexis de Tocqueville was amazed by Americans' penchant for creating and joining associations. He thought it was important, too, and not just for the obvious reason, that associations helped Americans educate themselves about the important public issues on which they'd be voting. What he thought was even more important is that by participating in associations, Americans train the political muscles and develop social skills required by a democratic society. They learn that there were a variety of defensible positions on any given issue. They learned how to frame legislation in the form of bylaws. They learned how to debate and negotiate and compromise. They learned how to elect officers who would represent them and how to give in when they were outvoted. Something that may not be true longer. I mention this at the very outset of my talk for two reasons. First, I think Tocqueville would have appreciated Humanities West because it's the kind of typically American organization he had in mind. And so I'd like to thank everyone who takes the time to help run Humanities West, and all of you who've come here tonight to participate in what really is a very typically American institution. Second, Tocqueville's comments actually are related to what I'll be talking about tonight. Tocqueville was not the first to point it out. Socrates and Plato already had long before Tocqueville, and Edmund Burke pointed it out again just shortly before him. But Tocqueville was one of the first to express the idea in a form that was modernly analytically rigorous. The idea is this: laws and governments are among the least important things that maintain the fabric of societies, that determine whether societies are adaptive or dysfunctional. Far more important,
Oops, we lost you.
Hello? Shall I go back to this one?
No, go ahead.
Okay. Far more important are values and practices that are never institutionalized. What I'm going to try to explain tonight is why Charlemagne was essential to the establishment of values and practices that shaped contemporary Western Europe. Values and practices that the United States also shared, but to a much lesser extent, so that despite all that we have in common, we don't quite see things the same way. So, on to Charlemagne. This is not what he looked like. Nor is this. Much worse painting. And neither is this, even though it's the image that is used on the poster for this session of Humanities West. But then, we actually have no idea what Charlemagne looked like. Even images that are closer to his own time aren't at all accurate. On the right, we see Charlemagne as a lawgiver, but this is a standard iconographic pose that's repeated many times in the early Middle Ages for many different kings. On the left, we see a very different Charlemagne, the large open eyes staring straight ahead, unblinking, all-seeing, the perfect symmetry of the face, and not least, the long, healthy, absolutely virile mane of hair. This simply shows Charlemagne with the idealized attributes of the ideal ruler. None of these images then show Charlemagne as he was. All of them show him as people thought a great ruler should look like. And that was as true for Albert Durer in the 16th century as it was for Adhemar of Chabannes in the 11th century. Not even Charlemagne's seal shows what he actually looked like, even though it bears his name. For the seal was based on an antique gem, in this case probably of Antoninus Pius, showing a Roman emperor as philosopher. That's why there's the beard. Philosophers had beards in Roman iconography. The best contemporary image of Charlemagne may be a silver denarius minted in his name in 813, but it's based on coins minted by the Roman emperor who was the model for all medieval emperors, Constantine the Great. So really, it's no more believable than any other image, though at least it shows one element that we know to be correct. Charlemagne did have a mustache. Our best contemporary information for what he looked like comes from his biographer, Einhard, who knew him well. Einhard says that Charlemagne was big and strong in body, but not more than seemed right, for his height was 7 times the length of his foot. I don't know either. The top of his head was round, his nose was a little longer than average, his eyes large and active, his hair a handsome gray color, his face lively and happy. His neck was thick and a bit short, and his belly stuck out a little, but this was balanced by the fine proportion of his other features. He carried himself with authority and dignity, whether he was standing or sitting. He possessed a firm, manly step, and a voice that rang out, although it seemed a little higher pitched than you would expect from somebody of his stature. And he was blessed with perfect health until the last 4 years of his life, when he grew lame in one foot and was weakened by fevers, and his doctors told him that he had to lay off the roasts that he liked so much and stick to boiled meat, which is why he hated his doctors. But this is really of no more value than the images that we have of Charlemagne. The large, lively eyes are again the sign of an active, vigilant king. The clear voice and the manly step are the attributes of a king who has the bearing to command and be obeyed. The balanced proportions of Charlemagne's limbs are the outward sign of the inner virtue that a king needed to rule, moderation. So even Einhard's description of Charlemagne really doesn't count for much. All we really know, in fact, is this, that in the late 1980s, a group of German scientists and doctors removed Charlemagne's bones from the reliquary in which they'd been placed in the 13th century, and measuring them, they estimated his height at no more than 6 feet and his weight at 156 pounds. This is not the only matter in which Einhard cannot fully be trusted. For example, in a really well-known passage, at least if you're a medieval historian, Einhard writes that with respect to Charlemagne's imperial coronation in 800 by Pope Leo III, that Charlemagne was caught completely unawares by the Pope's action, and that he later stated that he would never have gone into St. Peter's if he had known in advance what the Pope planned. It's pretty much indisputable, in fact, that the coronation had been very carefully choreographed in advance, and that the details of the ceremony had been worked on for at least 6 months, and that the idea of some sort of imperial title had probably been developing since 790 or so. In another famous passage, Einhard tells us that Charlemagne could speak Latin and understood Greek, and that he was taught a variety... Can I do that? Einhard tells us that Charlemagne could speak Latin and understood Greek, and that he was taught in a variety of disciplines, including grammar. But he never learned to write very well, even though he kept writing tablets under his pillow so that he could practice when he woke up at night, which was frequently, at least 4 times a night, Einhard says. This has always been used by historians who want to think of Charlemagne as a rough warrior, a still somewhat barbaric Frank, who was not very well educated and largely unable to follow the complicated ideas that his ecclesiastical advisors were writing about. But really, nothing could be further from the truth. It's pretty clear that Charlemagne could read. In any case, during much of the Middle Ages, those in positions of power did not read in public, even when they knew how to read. They were instead read to out loud. And reading and writing were regarded as completely different skills, with writing being much less necessary than reading. An author was literally an authority, who often dictated what he wanted written. The scribe himself was regarded as a mere technician, not an intellectual, not an author, not an authority. So Charlemagne could have been considered perfectly learned without knowing how to write. He certainly understood complicated political and theological problems. These two images are from the Opus Caroli, written about 793. Its purpose was to refute what the Carolingian court thought was a Byzantine heresy about the veneration of images. It's a huge work, comprising over 450 folio pages in a modern edition. And the margins are studded with comments about very arcane issues, comments like acute, notabile, perfecte sicula, in other words, penetrating, noteworthy, really perfect. Not all of these were, but many of them, were the comments of Charlemagne himself as the book was read out and discussed before him. He was no dim-witted barbarian. Among the other things that Einhard tells us about Charlemagne, he writes of his love of his mother and his sister Gisela and his sons and his daughters and his wives. Now, I'm sorry this slide doesn't quite show well, but you can't fit it all legibly on a single slide. One of my pet bugaboos about like any kind of a textbook, or for that matter, even really good history works, is that whenever they do genealogy so they can fit them on a page, they always leave out the things that make the genealogies really interesting for the sake of simplicity. So this is better, but you can't see it. But it's good. In fact, Charlemagne had lots of sons and daughters, and daughters by a lot of different women. He had 4 known official marriages, and after the death of his 4th wife, he had at least 7 known liaisons. By these women, he had at least 19 children. Many of these children were by his 2nd wife, Hildegard. She was later called the Mother of Kings because only her sons came to be considered throne-worthy, meaning that only her sons were able to succeed to the throne. You have to wonder what the title would have meant to her. Charlemagne married her when she was about 14. In 11 years of marriage, she gave birth 9 times. It wore her out, literally. She died when she was only 25 or 26. Even by Frankish standards, this was not common and not entirely proper. Einhard himself hints that Charlemagne's behavior towards his daughters was what we might call a bit off. For he says that he loved his daughters so much that he kept them with him at all times, even when he was traveling, and that he refused to allow any of them to marry. But Einhard's purposely leaving something out. Charlemagne refused to allow his daughters to marry, but he did allow them to establish public sexual relationships, ongoing and long-term, with high-ranking members of the aristocracy. It was a way for him to create a cadre of aristocrats who posed no danger to the throne, but who were completely dependent on his continuing favor for their success. In fact, in the last years of his reign, when Charlemagne was lame in one foot and suffered from fevers and could no longer eat his favorite roasts, and when two of his three heirs had died, and only the least favorite son was left of his heir, and as the empire was already beginning to show signs of the troubles that would destroy it, in these last 4 years of the reign, it seems clear that his daughters and their consorts were the ones actually running political affairs, and if they didn't run them, then they certainly had a great say in the political affairs. This was a cause of considerable murmuring, so much so that the very first thing Charlemagne's son and successor did was to get rid of his sisters and their consorts by expelling them from the palace. Frankly, it's a bit disappointing. I kind of preferred this Charlemagne. It's more in keeping with the myth of Charlemagne and with his very real importance, the importance of his conquests and of his governmental reforms, of the literature produced during his reign. How important was he? There are many measures, but this is my favorite, and I think the most revealing. This is a map of the Carolingian Empire at the time of Charlemagne's death in 814. And this is a map of the European Economic Community at the time of its foundation in 958. It's almost identical with the map of Charlemagne's empire, right down to the absence of Denmark and Spain and the division of East and West Germany at the Elbe River, the limits of Charlemagne's conquests. Admittedly, it's not entirely identical. Switzerland and Austria were part of the empire, but not part of the first common market. So here's, to me, an even more remarkable map. It shows the border between NATO and the Warsaw Pact as of 1955, when the Warsaw Pact was first implemented. What it shows is that what had been part of the Carolingian Empire never became part of the Warsaw Pact, and the states that were members of the Warsaw Pact had never been part of the Carolingian Empire. One of Charlemagne's own contemporaries called him the father of Europe. For a change, a Carolingian author is telling us the truth. How can that be? Not how can it be that he's telling them the truth, but how can it be that Charlemagne actually was the father of Europe? The answer goes back to the very conditions by which Charlemagne's family became kings of the Franks. Charlemagne's dynasty is known as the Carolingians, from the Latin Carolus, Charles in Latin. The name doesn't come from Charles the Great, but from his grandfather, Charles Martel. But Charles Martel was never king. The kings were a different dynasty, the Merovingians. And the Merovingians had ruled the Franks since about the 480s for over 250 years. By around 780, the Merovingian kings had very little real power. The real power was held by officials known as the mayors of the palace, who were kind of cross between prime ministers and chief of staff. They were chosen from whatever aristocratic faction happened to be dominant at court at the time. In thinking about the rise of the Carolingians, the important facts are these. First, there was not just one Merovingian kingdom. There were 2 primary kingdoms, one called Neustria, the other called Austrasia. Sometimes they were ruled by a single king, but even more often they were ruled by 2 different kings, whether brothers or cousins or fathers and sons. Whether they were ruled, however, by the same king or by different kings, each kingdom was distinct. The two kingdoms had their own different laws, very different languages, quite distinct aristocracies, very different senses of their own histories, and very different political interests and religious cultures. And so each had its own mayor of the palace. Generally, the Austrasians did not want to be ruled by Neustrians, and the Neustrians did not want to be ruled by Austrasians, and so the separation of the two kingdoms remained. Second, in the early decades of the sixth century, just after 500, the first Merovingian kings had conquered a vast swath of territories out of the remnants of the old Western Roman Empire, but they ruled those territories that they conquered very loosely. For the most part, the provinces were ruled by aristocratic leaders, usually with the title of duke, sometimes with the title of patrician. There were therefore dukes or patricians in Aquitaine, Bavaria, Thuringia, Provence, and Alemannia, and also Frisia. For the most important of these dukes, the foundation of their legitimacy was that they had been appointed to their offices, their families had been appointed to their offices in perpetuity by the Merovingian kings. So these dukes would not want to see the Merovingian dynasty abolished because the kings were the theoretical source of their right to rule over the aristocracies of their own territories. And none of the provincial dukes would have wanted to see the royal dynasty abolished to the benefit of another aristocratic family that they regarded as their equals, hardly as their superiors. Third, Northern Italy was ruled by an entirely different dynasty of kings from an entirely different ethnic group, the Lombards. And finally, beyond the edges of the Frankish kingdoms in the north and the northeast lived a welter of Germanic and Slavic peoples, of whom the most important were the Saxons. And the Saxons were entirely independent. They had never been ruled by any kings at all, because they absolutely refused to be ruled by kings, even their own kings. Instead, they were ruled as an oligarchy of aristocrats, all of whom regarded each other as equals. One of the reasons Charles Martel was important is that he ruled as mayor of the palace in both Neustria and Austrasia. He was really the first mayor in Merovingian history to do so successfully. His son Pippin became mayor on his father's death in 741, and 10 years later had deposed the last Merovingian ruler and became king of the Franks himself. His son Charlemagne ruled first as king and then in 800 as emperor, crowned in Rome by Leo III. This was a very speedy ascent from mayors of the palace to kings to emperor in just over 50 years. But it was also a very messy ascent because Pippin was not the only son of Charles Martel and Charlemagne was not the only son of Pippin. They each had brothers and those brothers had sons. Meaning that part of the victory of Pippin and Charlemagne was to make those brothers and nephews disappear. One of the most important findings in my lifetime, one of the greatest changes in our understanding of the period, is the realization of just how violent the rise of the Carolingians was and how much resistance they faced both as mayors and as kings. Because the rise of Charles Martel, Pippin, and Charlemagne upended that unwritten constitution that had governed continental Western Europe politics, European politics, for a good century and a half. The Carolingians ended the separate existence of Neustria and Austrasia. They reduced the autonomy of the different duchies and finally abolished their autonomy entirely. They conquered the Saxons and subjected them to kingship for the first time, not just Frankish kingship, but any kingship at all. They conquered the Lombard kingdom, deposed its kings, and placed the kingdom under direct Frankish rule. And of course, they deposed the reigning Merovingian dynasty and established themselves as kings in its place. My personal belief is that almost everything that was most innovative and important about the Carolingians had its source in what was really a crisis of legitimacy. The most important of these innovations is usually called the Carolingian reform. Some of the basic principles of that reform were laid down under Charlemagne's father, even before he became king. But the greatest changes came with Charlemagne himself, beginning in the late 1180s. The date is significant. By the 780s, Charlemagne had completed not only the fusion of Austrasia and Neustria, but also the conquest of and integration of the independent duchies. In 774, he conquered the Lombards. In 781, he made one of his sons king of the Lombards. Also in 781, he ended the independence of Aquitaine and made another of his sons a king of Aquitaine. In 785, he received the submission of the last great independent Saxon chieftain. And finally, in 788, he deposed the last of the independent dukes of Bavaria. That duke's name was Tassilo. And the details of his submission are important. They're recorded in a history known as the Royal Frankish Annals. It's not exactly an official history, but it's close enough for our purposes. The Annals was begun precisely at this time in the wake of Tassilo's submission, and so the history and Tassilo's submission are very closely related to each other. According to its account, Charlemagne ordered Tassilo to come to an assembly in Frankish territory where he was formally accused of treason. Rather than denying the charge, Tassilo confessed to everything. He admitted that he had conspired with Charlemagne's enemies to kill him. He also admitted that the story was true, that he really had said that even if he had 10 sons, he would rather that they all died rather than be subject to the Franks. And then comes a crucial statement. After all this had been proved against him, Franks, Bavarians, Lombards, and Saxons, and whoever else had come from every province to this assembly, condemned him to death. In fact, Charlemagne spared Tassilo the death sentence. Instead, he allowed Tassilo to be tonsured and enter a monastery and do penance for the rest of his life. With that, Charlemagne took over Bavaria and began to appoint his own governors in the province. The important point is this. The judgment against Tassilo was determined by Franks, Bavarians, Lombards, Saxons, and representatives of all the other provinces of Charlemagne's empire. Perhaps you can see why. In condemning Tassilo and suppressing Bavarian independence, it was essential that Charlemagne not present this as a power grab by the Franks alone, because that would simply make it a power grab by the Franks. The show trial, and that's what it was, had to be legitimated as an act of justice. And to make it appear just, the judgment had to be determined not by Franks only, but by all the peoples of the empire taken together. But this is a very unsatisfying kind of empire. It's just a motley assortment of autonomous peoples, each with their own laws, their own languages, their own traditions. The question is how to integrate them into a whole. And that's where the church came in, and that's where the Carolingian reform really begins. For what one sees in the 790s, immediately after these events, is a growing tendency to identify the church and the empire. The church and the empire became the same entity seen from different perspectives. If that's true, then an imperative follows necessarily. If the church and the empire are the same entity, then the same principles that inform the church had to inform the empire also. You can see the results of this fusion in a wide array of developments, such as the increasing coordination of bishops and counts, the clear tendency to make ecclesiastical rituals or ecclesiastical liturgies more political, and to make political rituals more liturgical. But the most interesting change has to do with political assemblies and ecclesiastical councils. Earlier, at least on the council on the continent, councils of the church and political assemblies had been kept fairly strictly distinct. Under the Carolingians, and especially under Charlemagne after the 780s, churchmen and lay leaders joined together in a single gathering, a gathering that was at once both an ecclesiastical council and a political assembly. For deliberating on details, the different constituent groups might separate into different meetings, one for bishops, one for monks, one for lay leaders, but they would begin as a single assembly, and they would end by recombining as one. There could be no more graphic demonstration that the church and the empire were the same single entity. And their identification had a very specific implication. If the church and the empire were one, then the empire had to become a thoroughly Christian empire. And Christian morality became an essential duty of inhabitants of the empire, as both Christians and as subjects of the emperor. It's only in the last generation of scholars, and really only in the last 10 years or so, that we've begun to understand just how important this aspect of the Carolingian reform was. It's clearest in the texts known as capitularies. The first great one is known as the Admonitio Generalis. It was promulgated in 789, immediately after Tassilo's fall. Its first 59 articles are a carefully chosen selection from an earlier collection of ecclesiastical canons, But the last 20 articles are quite different. And the difference is clear immediately in the first two additional articles, Article 60 and 61. Here is Article 60. To all, meaning laymen, monks, and secular clergy together. First, that the Catholic faith be diligently read out and preached to bishops and priests, to all the people, for this is the first command of the omnipotent Lord God in the law. Hear, O Israel, that the Lord your God is one God, and he shall be loved with all our heart and all our mind and all our soul and all our strength. Basically, this makes the fundamental law of the Carolingian Empire the first fundamental law announced by Christ in the Gospels, a law which itself was taken over from Deuteronomy. The next article announces the second fundamental law, the one taken from the same Gospels, and this time from Leviticus, that there be peace, concord, and unanimity among all the Christian people, between bishops, abbots, and judges, and counts, and all persons everywhere, whether greater or lesser, since nothing is pleasing to God without peace, as we read in the Gospels where the Lord himself ordered it, for this is the second command in the law, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And again in the Gospels, blessed be the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Now, this emphasis on peace becomes one of the most common refrains in the Carolingian Reform, that the empire is an empire maintained by peace. That does not mean an absence of war against outsiders. Carolingian peace means harmony within society, obtained through compromise, consensus, and agreement among equals. Agreement between bishops and bishops, counts with counts, but also harmony among all Christian members of the empire together, no matter what their status, commoners and the great alike. I really like the next one, but I do not want to run out of time. And I think you get the point. Admittedly, the Carolingian ideal of peace, concord, and charity was strongly hierarchical. You wouldn't expect anything else in a pre-modern monarchy governed by a military aristocracy, whether in Western Europe or anywhere else in the world. So it's not surprising that Charlemagne's capitularies consistently emphasize the need to maintain perfect order, where order is the duty of the lesser to obey the greater. So children are to love their parents and honor them. Wives are to be subject to their husbands. Clerics must obey their bishops, monks must obey their abbots, and nobles have the power to judge and to punish. But the full context of such statements gives a somewhat different impression. The full context consistently mitigates the emphasis on hierarchy with an equal emphasis on mutuality and social obligation. Let a wife be subject to her husband in all goodness and purity, but let a husband love his wife. Counts and judges punish, but they are also called sharers in the royal ministry, and they must therefore exercise their ministries according to the same ethical standards that apply to kings. They must judge righteously with compassion for the poor. They must shun bribery. They must not use their power to punish the innocent or oppress them. Above all, they must always hold this in their hearts, that just as they judge, so they will be judged by God at the end of time. And so they shall judge with mercy, so that God will show mercy to them. In any case, the vast bulk of these kinds of texts has nothing to do with enforcing respect for authority. The vast bulk is ethical, and it applies to every subject in the empire. Love your neighbor as yourself. Live in peace with each other. Help the oppressed. Care for strangers and give alms to the poor. Visit the sick and be merciful to prisoners. Do not commit theft. Do not commit murder. Do not fornicate. Avoid lawsuits motivated solely by a desire for gain. Avoid perjury. Avoid drunkenness. Avoid adultery and usury. Avoid all excess profiteering in selling food and drink, even in times of scarcity, or rather, especially in times of scarcity. Know that if we want to obtain the mercy of God, we should be merciful to others. Carolingian political ethics insisted on the need for order and obedience. That can't be disputed. But if we focus only on this, then we blind ourselves to something which is much more interesting and in the long run was far more important. Carolingian legislation did not only demand that subjects obey leaders, By virtue of their membership in a Christian society, every single individual had moral responsibilities, and not just moral responsibilities, but essentially the same moral responsibilities. Whether they addressed kings or aristocrats, leaders or subjects, ordinary laypersons or monks, Carolingian moralists applied the same ethics to all, noble and commoner, leader and follower, Saxon and Frank, Bavarian and Lombard, even men and women, and free and unfree. There was a single Carolingian ethics and a single Carolingian political morality. The full force of these kinds of expectations can be seen in one of Charlemagne's most famous capitularies, one that followed his imperial coronation in 800. That each and every person strive to fully keep his own person in the holy service of God, according to the precept of God, and according to his promise, according to the capacity of his understanding and his ability, because the Lord Emperor cannot himself show the necessary concern and disciplining in every single thing. Now, you may not think that this is extraordinary, but then you haven't been reading Carolingian sources for as long as I have. In the context of Carolingian society, this I find to be an extraordinary, startling statement. Quite simply, what it says is that a government cannot do it all. We are each individually responsible for ourselves and for others. We are individually responsible for our own ethical behavior. We are each king of ourselves. We must each govern ourselves. This idea that individuals are ultimately responsible for their own ethical behavior is the real reason for Charlemagne's well-known attention to education, or better, I think, as the French and German have it, formation. Because ethics requires reason and understanding and an individual's active commitment. And so, ethics cannot be legislated, it must be taught. And it was taught across an astonishingly wide array of platforms, in ethical treatises for kings and nobles, in capitularies of Charlemagne, but also in capitularies of bishops, in the synods where the episcopal capitularies were announced, in the general assemblies where the royal capitularies were recited, in local county courts where bishops and counts repeated the injunctions made in the synods and the general assemblies, in instructions given to godparents for educating their godchildren, in sermons on Sundays and feast days, and in prayers. In all of these texts, one finds the same exhortations to the same ethical behavior. Bishops are to preach in churches, and royal legates are to teach in local public assemblies. They are to teach not simply that usury is wrong, but exactly what it is and why it's wrong, because usury is associated with greed, and greed is the root of all evil. They are to teach that homicide is wrong, and also why it's wrong, because we are all children of God, so that any homicide is a kind of fratricide. They are to teach that all should avoid drunkenness, but leaders especially, so that followers may learn from their example. All of this, priests are to teach as best as they are able. And if they know nothing else, they can at least teach the people this, that they shall renounce evil and do good and seek peace and follow it. Having said all this, I don't want to make the Carolingians out to be paragons of virtue. They weren't. Carolingian rulers could be cunning and cruel. And personally, I find them too self-righteous to admire. I recently tried to do a search of Carolingian humor. I found one example, a poem about Charlemagne's baldness, about Charles the Bald's baldness, and it's not funny. They're just dour. In the course of a 30-year-long war against the Saxons, Charlemagne had 4,500 Saxon prisoners of war executed. When unrest continued, he declared the harshest possible martial law against a people he regarded as rebels, punishing every conceivable offense with death, from conspiracy against the king to failure to pay tithes or observe Lent. When resistance continued, he finally began the wholesale deportation of the most hostile Saxons, removing them from their villages and transporting them to settlements within Frankish territories, while a friendly Slavic tribe was called in to colonize the deserted lands. All such actions could be justified according to contemporary understandings of Christian imperial authority. In fact, they illustrate, and if at an extreme, the godly ruler's desire, duty to correct and to discipline. Nevertheless, they're not the whole story. Alcuin of York, whom Fred Astrid mentioned, spoke out respectfully but firmly against the harshness with which Charlemagne treated the Saxons, arguing that it was entirely counterproductive, that teaching made for better converts than force. In fact, it was counterproductive, as Charlemagne himself finally realized in the face of continuing Saxon resistance. So he rescinded the martial law, and he installed a very different regime in which Saxons enjoyed the same legal rights and legal procedures as Franks. With this, I can finally return to my original question, the importance of Charlemagne's reign in the history of Western Europe. For Charlemagne's reforms really did have an effect. Historians have not often perceived it because it operated over a glacially long period of time, not years or decades, but centuries. And it was often an ugly process with ever angrier revolutions and ever more destructive wars and equal, if not greater, social injustices. And yet, there was an effect. Charlemagne's empire did not last very long, in some ways only 40 years, from his coronation as emperor in 800 to the death of his son Louis the Pious in 840. Soon after Louis' death, the empire was already falling apart. But its ideal of a political society as an ecclesial community, that endured. It was received in new settings, adapted to new circumstances, and transformed in its underlying ideology, but it endured. And the idea that individuals had moral responsibilities both to themselves and to their societies as a whole, that also endured. If anything, it became even more important over time. By the later Middle Ages, the Carolingian idea of individual ethical responsibility and the very categories of what ethical responsibility was, ethical behavior was, ended up penetrating deep into counties and castellanies and towns and villages, even in England, because the kingdom was conquered by a sequence of princes from formerly Carolingian lands. Those who were upright men and women in their communities were called good men, or true men, or good women, or honest men and honest women, the exact same terms that had been used in the Carolingian period. I don't want that one in. Uh-oh. Oh, and now I got. Oh, are you back there looking in? Yeah, there we go. Okay. There we go. What made these men and women good and true and honest was their ethical uprightness, defined exactly as Charlemagne's capitularies had defined it: avoiding drunkenness, avoiding gambling, avoiding blasphemy, avoiding illicit sexual relationships, having a single marriage in which husbands led, but husbands and wives respected each other, giving alms and charity to the poor. The Carolingian ideal of the community also continued. A village community or an urban community was very much conceived of as a moral community, defined by parish boundaries, knit together by Christian rituals, and saturated with Christian moral and ethical teachings, now less an ideology of authority than of social uprightness. In France and England, it was called le commun. In Germany, the Gemein. But everywhere in Western Europe, community became the rallying cry for reform movements. Some of those reform movements were led by political elites, but just as many were led by peasants and artisans in rebellions against elites, especially in and after the 14th century and on into the 16th and 17th centuries. And in all these cases, all of these reforms were justified by the idea that the political community was a moral community that encompassed all society. The same idea that the political community was a moral community later infused the ideal of the total Christian community in radical Protestantism, whether in England, Germany, Switzerland, or the English colonies in the Americas. But it also remained the ideal of local communities of villagers, artisans, and workers, what the British historian E.P. Thompson called the moral economy of the crowd. In the early 19th century, the ideal of the moral economy of the community was re-Christianized and re-universalized by Christian reformers like Methodists, who preached the need of a Christian society to protect exactly the same categories as the Carolingians sought to protect, widows, orphans, and the poor. And then, something very interesting happened. By the 1830s and 40s, unrestrained industrialization in England had created social injustices and environmental degradation hardly rivaled even by today's most rapidly industrializing economies. Economic liberalism justified these excesses. The first effective organized movement against liberal theory and its real-world effects came in a movement known as Chartism, so-called because it promoted the adoption of a national charter that would protect the rights of workers. But Chartists did not simply limit themselves to an economic platform. They demanded, for example, the vote for all adult males regardless of class or property qualifications, on the grounds that only political representation would lead to significant economic and political reforms. Given this democratic program, you might think that Chartism had nothing in common with the Carolingian reform. And yet, Chartism's program grew out of the moral economy of the local English communities, and one of its most important influences was Methodism. And in the case of both Methodism and Chartism, if you pare away their democratic goals, what you find at the core is a recognizably ecclesial ideal of the common social good, and a social ethic that recognizably descends from the Carolingian reform. There's the same emphasis on the social obligation of individuals. There's the same understanding that in the just society, the powerful must help the poor. There's the same insistence on upright living as a condition of participation in the political process. There are even the same vices that the upright are to shun: gambling, drunkenness, and sexual promiscuity. Not least, you find the same understanding that the key to instilling ethical awareness in the individual is education. Something very similar was true of social democracy on the European continent, especially as it developed after World War II. It's easy to overlook the similarities because social democracy originally advocated universal suffrage and a separation of church and state, and it was grounded in an assumption that society was divided into classes whose interests were fundamentally opposed to each other. And all of these traits are obviously the exact opposite of the principles that govern the Carolingian reform. And yet, if you look more deeply, you find principles that are fundamentally ecclesial and ultimately Carolingian. A strong insistence that justice is a matter of equity and not law. A commitment to the belief that government should not simply protect individual interests, but also promote the common good. The belief that a common social bond requires an awareness that individuals in society have moral obligations towards each other, and an understanding that those obligations are intrinsically ethical rather than legal, and that the key to instilling ethical values is, once more, education. In 1959, the entirety of the program was summarized in two virtues: responsibility for self and social obligation. Are these not the very virtues that were promoted by the leaders of the Carolingian reform? For that matter, are they not the very virtues that were promoted and demanded by Charlemagne in his 802 Capitulary? In effect, what social democracy did was to take God and the church out of the ecclesial society, leaving an ecclesial morality and a Christian understanding of the moral responsibility of the individual. Much changed in the 1,000 years between the collapse of the Carolingian Empire and the emergence of social democracy. But this result was also true, that without the Carolingian reform, there would have been no social in social democracy. Of course, you can see the problems. First, there are those liberal ideals that also became part of social democracy, and thankfully and necessarily so, because without them, we easily end up not with an ecclesial society that is just, but with fascism. Also, second, social democracy emerged in strongly unified European states whose social ethic built on a common Christian tradition, even when Christianity had dropped out of the ethics. That commonality no longer holds true, and to try to enforce it goes against everything we believe. Even if we believe that it should be done, it wouldn't be possible to do it, given the diversity of today's global societies. So we really are at a turning point today. Perhaps really the first time that this has occurred, certainly in European history, where the past provides very little help in providing in creating our future, and may even, as one of my colleagues, Pat Geary, has argued, may actually hinder us from creating a future which is different and adaptive and progressive. Nevertheless, that doesn't diminish the importance of what was accomplished in an empire that lasted a scant 40 years. Thank you very much.
You can see he spent a lifetime studying the era of Charlemagne. Please thank him again. Our practice here at Humanities West is to only have questions and answers during the panel discussion on Saturday afternoon. So even if you won't be here tomorrow, we know you will, but please go to the display table and get the question cards and fill out your questions, and we'll answer as many as we possibly can. Fred will be fielding all those questions at 3 o'clock tomorrow afternoon. We'll take a break. If you'd like to have a drink, please know that you can bring your drinks back into the theater if you cover them. So, we'll have an intermission.
Yes.
I'm going to go to the next one.